And offered incense at the high places. The king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the principal high place. Solomon used to offer 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown it in steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, although I am only a little child, and I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this, your great people? It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life or riches, or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I will now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after. I give you also what you have not asked, both riches and honor all your life. No other king shall compare with you. If you walk in my ways, keeping my statutes and my commandments, as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your life. God's word for his people. Thanks be to God.
Oh, passage today about Solomon making the right choice, so I won't reiterate that for you. But as I was reading this passage, what struck me were the early verses, something I had never noticed before, so that's where I'd like to go. So we're in 1 Kings chapter 3, and I am going to look at verse 3. Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David, except that he sacrificed and burned incense at the high places. So what are these high places? They're typically elevated locations for worship. They were used by the patriarchs before the tabernacle, and they were also used by the pagans in their worship. Over time, however, this term came to be associated just with pagan worship, so that any time you have a reference in the Bible to high places, it's referring to pagan worship. And that's regardless of where it was located. So we have Jeremiah in chapter 7, verse 31, locating a high place in a valley. And then in 2 Kings 23, we read about high places that are in a city. So it doesn't matter that they're elevated anymore. We know that this term means pagan worship. These high places were often local shrines and included altars where incense and sacrifices were made, and festivals and feasts held in this area. A little later in Kings, we're told about the influence of Solomon's many foreign wives. He had 700 wives, 300 concubines. And in chapter 11 of 1 Kings, we learn that Solomon built high places for the pagan gods Chemosh and Molech, and for all of his wives' foreign gods. So, this is the situation. Solomon offering sacrifices at a high place. This is the context of God showing up. Solomon isn't in the tabernacle where Israel's worship was supposed to take place, and that's where I would expect that God would show up if he was going to show up, right? But thankfully, that's not how God works. God is with us in the midst of our mess, in the midst of our screw-ups, in the midst of our sinful lives, in the midst of our pagan worship. So I'd like to focus on three critical things about these early verses in chapter 3. And the first thing is the but in verse 3. It's translated only in the NRSV, translated except in some of the other versions. It says, Solomon loved the Lord, but... We like to categorize sins, don't we? We've got the big ones, like adultery and the little white lies over here. Well, in the same ranking business, I would think pagan worship would be kind of in the biggie category, wouldn't you? So Solomon loved the Lord, but he made sacrifices and offered incense in high places. It's easy to get all righteous and justify ourselves, isn't it? Well, I'm not like that guy over there. Well, at least I'm not over offering pagan worship like Solomon. But really, we're no different from Solomon, are we? The wisest man who ever lived is flawed. And God still shows up. We're all flawed, aren't we? We love the Lord, but you fill in the blank. In the end, it doesn't matter how minor or how major our sin, because God still shows up. So the first point I want to make, and that's your blank on your handout, is let's just acknowledge the buts in our life. And not only that, but because of that, let's give grace to others. Realizing we're all flawed. We're told this in Romans 3:23. We've all sinned and fallen short. And this is actually good news, folks. God is with us. God still shows up for us even in the midst of our messy lives. And now I want to look at verse 4. Now, the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there. That was the great high place. Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. Well, he certainly couldn't claim this as one little slip-up. As a side note, remember that the temple was not yet built. Solomon is going to build the temple. The tabernacle's our last known location for the tabernacle anyway. It wasn't Gibeon. That's where the story takes place. But the ark was stolen, remember, by the Philistines, and David recaptured it, and it went down to Jerusalem. So the ark isn't even there. And we don't know if the tabernacle is, you know, the material is by now. It may not even exist, but that's where we know it last existed. But what we do know, in verse 2, it says, we're told that there was no house of worship for the Lord. And worship in Gibeon had become corrupt, to where we now have Solomon offering sacrifices to pagan gods. So, well, let's give him a break. Maybe Solomon was just covering all of his bases. Maybe he's just running through his life in a flurry of activity, throwing everything against the wall, hoping something's going to stick. But reading this, I was struck by how sometimes that's me too. I can get so busy doing 1,000 different God things that I don't stop to consider what it is that really matters to God. 1,000 burnt offerings is a lot, but it's not the volume or the busyness of the things we do for God, but the intention of our hearts and our seeking to do what God has planned for us rather than being consumed with our own plans. There's a story about a man who dies and goes to heaven, and St. Peter shows him around. And they're walking down a hall. He looks into this room, and he sees this bookshelf, and it's full of volumes of books. And he says, what's this? And St. Peter says, oh, those are the books about your life. A little further down the hall, he looks in another room, and he sees this huge library, bookshelf after bookshelf, volumes of books. And he says, what's this? And St. Peter said, oh, those are the books about the plans God had for you. I have to ask myself if sometimes I'm so busy carrying out my own plans that I've neglected to listen to what God's plans may be for my life. What are my 1,000 sacrifices? So the second point on your handout is, let's focus less on our plans and consider instead what plans God may have for us. The last thing I want to look at is in verse 5. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night. God shows up in a place of pagan worship. This just blew me away. As many times as I heard this story, I had never noticed that. It never ceases to amaze me how God shows up in my mess. We often think that we have to get it all together, we have to have on our Sunday best, God won't meet us unless we're in some fancy sanctuary, or worse yet, that we're not even good enough for God to take notice of us. Some feel that God is just out there, somewhere, out of reach. Diana Butler Bass talks about this in her book, Grounded. She explains how religion has focused over the last millennium on this vertical universe where God is way up there in heaven and we live here on this sinful, evil earth, and the terrors of hell threaten us from down below. And religion's job is to get us from here up to God in heavenly bliss. She says that religion's been functioning like a sort of holy elevator, getting us between earth and heaven and hell. An all-powerful, all-knowing, all-distant God in the clouds oversees the whole thing. People in the Bible thought the way to get to God was to build a tower, or by worshiping in high places. But over and over and over again, we see God showing up in the most unexpected places. In a burning bush, in a still, small voice, in a place of pagan worship, in the form of a baby, on a road to Emmaus or Damascus. While we continue our attempts to reach God, sometimes with great effort, all the while, God is already with us. I think most of the time the issue is that I simply fail to notice. So the third point I want to make is, let's just go ahead and acknowledge. Can we all agree that God is with us? Right here, right where we are at this moment. And then open our eyes, expecting to see. So the next question for us, or the question before us today is, how might we notice where God is showing up in our lives individually and corporately? And I have just a few suggestions. Maybe they'll be helpful. First, we need to set our intention to do so. We need to not only make a conscious decision, we need to speak truth to the fact that we're going to experience God each day. Just make that decision and speak it. And the corollary to this is that we may also need to stop some of the crazy busyness that pulls us in every direction except towards God. reminder or an appointment on your calendar. The monks and monasteries actually have been doing this for thousands of years. Well, maybe not using Outlook, but they ring a bell at certain times throughout the day as a reminder, no matter what they're doing. When they hear that bell, if they're weeding out in the garden, if they're cooking a meal for the community, they stop and think about God. Well, maybe you could set a reminder, use that fancy watch of yours that buzzes and tells you it's time to move. You've been sitting too long. Maybe when that buzz goes off, that's your cue to remember God. Or a visual jog. Put a post-it on your bathroom mirror. You don't have to write anything on it. When you walk by it, you'll know, oh, I'm supposed to stop and consider God. Or if you're a walker, maybe there's a particular tree you love to pass on and walk. And you can decide that when you see that tree, that's going to be your time to stop and think about God. If you like to journal, at the end of the day, maybe journal about when God showed up in your life. Or in the morning, think back on the previous day and notice where God showed up. Sometimes, maybe often, we only see God in hindsight. That's okay, because at least we notice. Corporately, since we're instructed to encourage each other, why don't we ask each other how God is showing up in our lives? What if instead of, how are you doing, we asked, where did God show up in your life this last week? How different would that conversation be? And finally, I think it's an important question that we should be asking ourselves corporately. Where is God showing up here at Southern Hills, and where might God want to take us? Could it be possible if we would just notice that God is showing up in our mess